Hello, it is Saturday mailbag time. I'm Perry Nemiroff. This is John Rocha, and this is the Collider Show, where we take your viewer-submitted questions. But before we get to any of those questions, I have a question for Mr. Rocha here.
Oh, no, yes.
Did you purposely put your pops backwards?
Did I really?
Yeah.
No, yeah, I did, because I want to focus on Shazam.
Sure.
There's Adam taking the graphic down. Thanks, Adam. any chance to embarrass me, he'll do. No, I wanted to focus on Shazam here, and I guess I didn't notice that they were backwards. But hey, the point is still there. Shazam is the focal point, even more so now.
It's a great cover-up. Good job. So you want to know how to submit questions for this show? You just yell them at Rocha like I did.
That's
Don't
right.
do that. Send them in to mailbag at... Jesus Christ.
Sure, mailbag@collider.com. You can also
send it on Twitter using the hashtag #ColliderMailbag. I don't understand why that happens, but it does all the time. You can also send them on Facebook and Instagram as well. Keep an eye out for the posts that go up every Wednesday over there.
Yeah.
We got a whole bunch of questions to get to.
We do.
Do you know what the one other reminder I have to give everybody?
Go ahead.
You've hosted it. I thought you knew it.
What's that?
I haven't trained him well.
No.
This show doesn't only exist in video form.
Oh,
where else
can
you find it?
The podcast channel.
Thank you.
Kaboom!
On the Collider Movie Talk feed, so go check it out there. Have all your friends and family listen. That would be much appreciated. All right.
Yeah, and if you're listening to us on the podcast, hello, how are you? Do you enjoy these voices?
Is that your podcast voice?
Yeah.
All right. Before the spiral is out of control any further, partially my fault. The first question today is a Twitter question, and it comes from J. Scott For Real, who writes, haven't heard much about MoviePass lately. Have they actually managed to save themselves from the brink of destruction, or is it still just a matter of time before the inevitable collapse? It's just like, as I started to read the question, I started to think about all the recent headlines I saw.
Yeah, there's been a lot going on here. The reason it's been quiet is because they haven't been fluctuating their prices up and down anymore, or sending those letters out to people over the last few weeks. Now they've got themselves embroiled in some kind of a situation. Helios and Matheson Analytics, that's the parent company of MoviePass, they're denying claims that it misled investors about its finances amid a fraud investigation that's happening with the New York Anti-Fraud Task Commission there. They're citing the Martin Act. There's a violation of the Martin Act. So that's why they probably stayed quiet, is because they want to focus all of their time on the legal stuff that's happening with MoviePass with these inquiries. Because if one state, one city starts going after them, this could spread across other states, other cities as well, and maybe it's a national thing that they'll go after them for. I don't know with the federal situation.
I mean, they haven't completely been quiet. I think I think this might be the last email blast I got regarding MoviePass.
Oh,
and the
yeah.
headline of this is that MoviePass Films and Neon packed on a two-picture deal. So that's probably the latest thing I've heard that does not pertain to this investigation that's going on here.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, in reading up about the investigation, I came across one tweet on an NBC write-up that really just struck me. And this Twitter user wrote, it's really impressive how MoviePass made me love going to the movies again and then made me loathe it. So this goes back to the very, very beginning, because we were constantly talking about how this bad practice, like, it's fun to go see as many movies as you want for a really, really low cost for a while.
Yeah.
But the problem with that business model, as cool as it is to get other people into movies that maybe they might not have seen otherwise, the downside to that is the super negative ripple effect that something like that has. You set people up and give them these wonderful expectations. You get used to seeing movies a certain way. And then all of a sudden, when you pull the rug out from under people, it's not just maybe a slow decline. It's basically a free fall. And that's what I don't want to see happen in the industry. I still think there's something to MoviePass. There's something to these subscription services that are absolutely genius. But I think it is very unfortunate that MoviePass didn't approach it with the long-term goals in mind.
Well, and you also have to look at this. What's your responsibility as a consumer, right? If you want to put yourself in a situation where you're going to be bamboozled or hoodwinked by a company, but you haven't done your own research, crunched the numbers financially, financially and just kind of lived in a fantasy world where you were like, $9.95 a month, great for all the movies. This seems totally financially viable and won't be a problem at all coming down the road. And I think that's where the mistake is too, is that we as consumers, we can be upset about it, I guess, but to be upset about it when you knew in your mind or in the back of your mind that this was not a tenable situation that could last for a long time. AMC in retaliation has their $20 or $19.95 thing that they do, but they limit it just to AMC, and you do get some perks. So that they'll lose a little bit of money on that, and if you go multiple times. But most people weren't going multiple times on MoviePass. They released numbers about that. So most people probably won't go multiple times to AMC. And AMC, with their $20 a month, at least they get you in the theater, and then they're selling refreshments to you. So even if you are the kind of person that goes multiple times a month, they're still recouping an investment, counting on the fact that you'll buy popcorn multiple times, Coke multiple times, candy multiple times, whatever they've got, pretzel bites, hot dogs, what have you. They got us all pizza.
I didn't realize you were so enthusiastic about pretzel bites.
Hey, listen, pretzel bites, as an East Coast boy, pretzel bites are the bomb.
That's actually
that
my concession stand food of choice if I were to eat something during the movie. But
exactly.
I don't know. When it came to the MoviePass thing, I always said, I'm not getting it because I know this is going to go bust eventually.
So you knew.
But I still wouldn't go to anybody out there and say, you are obligated to do the right thing and pass on this really great deal. It's like, I never would feel like putting pressure on someone to make that decision and put the weight of that on their own shoulders. Right. It doesn't seem fair. It seems more of an obligation to a company like MoviePass that not only wanted to get into the subscription service game, but make pacts with companies like Neon Films, get into production, get into distribution. If you are going to join this community as a big company like that, it is your obligation to do it in the best possible way, because otherwise it's like what do they say about like cats and, is it cats and dogs or something? Like you don't like shit where you sleep or something?
Yeah, sure.
Something like that, right?
It's more about like dating a coworker. You don't shit where you eat. Yeah, that kind of thing.
You don't shit where you eat?
Yeah, I don't know what cats and dogs, maybe thinking of Ghostbusters. Cats and dogs living together, mass hysteria. Listen, I do want to wrap this up real quick, just say you're right, Perry. I'm not saying anybody's wrong for doing it. I was a MoviePass member for a year and a half. I get it. My thing is though, you can't all of a sudden be disillusioned about it because it didn't work out when you knew it wasn't a tenable situation. But you had every right to go and be a MoviePass member. I enjoyed it for the
time.
You
don't bite the hand that feeds
there
you. That probably would have been a better one. Did I just make that up?
Good point, Perry. So let's move on to the second one. Oh boy, this is what happens when you take what was the pill you took? The
Zizol.
Zizol pill.
I think I took a couple.
With the sniffles. All right, this one comes from Twitter as well. This one is from @Sarge 21153. Should studios that want to adapt a video game property into a film, should they consider animation versus live action? I love Burr Studios game cinematics like Halo 2A or Blizzard's Overwatch animated shorts. Also, you get to keep the same voiceover actors from the games.
I think this is a great idea. Yeah. Also, because of this question, I watched some of those Overwatch animated shorts.
And they're great.
Even as someone coming at it that does not know anything about Overwatch, they were really good. They're really good, you know, 7 to 8 minute shorts that I think are beautifully designed. And the story is kind of fun, too.
Yeah, they're incredible characters, and they're fun to do. Blizzard really has come a long way with how they've created this content. And they kind of, I wouldn't say they pioneered it, but they certainly perfected it to a degree to create these kind of mini vignettes to promote their video game before it ever came out. And the style and the quality and the voiceover work, really incredible stuff. And I think it's left fans clamoring for a full-length Overwatch movie if that can be done. But sometimes just because you can make a short doesn't mean you can make a longer film. We've seen that happen.
Of course, but
numerous times.
But those shorts are a better proof of concept than some of the longer full length live action game adaptations that we've seen thus far.
Absolutely, don't disagree with you there. Assassin's Creed, Warcraft, which I didn't particularly care for as you go on. But this, I think this idea of turning it into a live action thing would be interesting. Overwatch would really work, but you have to get the right writers, you have to get the right people behind it to really understand the character. Because just because they can do 6 minutes doesn't mean ripping it out to 90 minutes or 2 hours that you're not going to lose something, or an hour 45, that you're not going to lose some of the nuance and complexity of the characters that you saw even in the shorts. You might be too overblown, too generous. generalized, and that's a mistake you can make there.
You never know. I think more so than anything when it comes to video game adaptations, we just need to rock the boat or something.
Yeah, sure.
Because we basically keep having the same discussion over and over. Mm-hmm. Every single time you get a straightforward adaptation. I'm not talking about something like Rampage. I think that's a different situation. But when you're talking about, let's say, Warcraft and Assassin's Creed, there's something missing from those movies. Mm-hmm. And it's like the same thing that's been missing with all the other adaptations that we've gotten before it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I can't really quite put a finger on exactly what that is. I think it's a lot of elements combined that make them, you know, lackluster movies. Yeah. But when it comes to having this major shakeup, like the idea of ditching live action and going to animation, I think there's so much potential there, especially because we're talking about video game adaptations here with this kind of stuff at its root, at its core. And if you figure out how to adapt that element of it to screen the right way, maybe that could at least put it back on the right path.
Yeah, and I have a lot of faith that that's going to happen, because what we saw, video games are just, what, 30 to 40 years old? They're not, and they've only over the last two decades really become, you got to get this game, you got to, and having these multiple storylines within the games that are very interesting and cinematic. So I think it's still a new industry compared to other media, so it's going to take some time to get to its point where people involved in it are going to branch out and do feature film adaptations who understand the game. That was the problem in the 90s with a lot of superhero movies. They didn't understand the movies they were making, or the characters, or the lore, or the mythology, and that affected what the overall effect, or the overall result of the film. Mm-hmm. Now we're better at it. Yeah, we still have missteps, obviously, but we're so much more better at it, I think, as a society, in creating these superhero movies, superhero TV shows that are more interesting, more real, and more personality based. I think that's coming. We're still in kind of a new era of video gaming. I think it's going to come as it goes along.
I don't know. I started to think about Warcraft and Duncan Jones in particular. It's weird because I feel like he got it. Like, mm-hmm. I had read so many interviews with him where it just seemed like passion through the roof. Mm-hmm. So with something like that, I'd place the blame more so than anything on script issues.
Yeah, sometimes it's that, and sometimes it's the actual studio of the video game who's like, no, you need to put this in, you need to put that in. You need to put that. And so they're going to find a happy medium at some point, I hope, because I think that's the only way we're going to get consistently good video game adaptations in the future.
Well, maybe that kind of leads us to why animated could be a better route, too, because with an animated movie, I think it's a much lengthier process in terms of development, and then seeing everything develop also as you go through production. It's like I'm picturing the Pixar process right now, with how it's storyboarded one way, and then you're making tweaks basically all along the way, and it's just such heavy discussion and heavy prep work that, you know, maybe just going with that format instead. Not that a lot of live action movies out there don't have extensive development processes too, but just the constant assessing and reassessing that has to happen when you're animating every single frame of a movie. Maybe, I don't know, maybe that is the path.
Those DC WB animated films kind of show you that. That most recent one with Constantine is getting great reviews from people, so it's certainly, there's possibilities there.
We shall see what happens. Yeah. All right, question number three is an email question from Chris Houston, who writes, "Hello, Collider folks. With the announcement of Suicide Squad 2 coming out, wouldn't it be more difficult to include Harley Quinn due to her being rescued by the Joker at the end of the original film? Didn't know if it would make the character seem less menacing since it showed her getting captured in the first one, then rescued only to get captured yet again. Also, who in the office can do the most burpees in 5 minutes? Thanks, and keep it sweaty." Because you were the one sitting here watching Suicide Squad for a while. I'll let you answer first.
There's a great YouTube. They have all the Harley Quinn scenes. That's what I was watching just to kind of get get my head around, like, what I get the question, the point of the question. But the thing about Harley Quinn is I don't think it matters that she got captured once or captured twice or whatever. If you watch the Batman animated series, Harley Quinn is captured multiple times and goes into Arkham multiple times. And so she's not some kind of, like, all of a sudden it ruins her mystique or her persona to be captured. But I get your point. So here's what I would say. It's absolutely possible to have Harley Quinn in Suicide Squad 2 for a number of reasons, because if we get a new take from James Gunn, it may not be that this is a Suicide Squad that is forced to come together. This could be a Suicide Squad that decides to come together. And the reason that, and you see that in the movie, they decide to band together to fight. So that may be the angle that they take that's a little more liberal with that story. So Harley Quinn decides to be part of the Suicide Squad again. She's not captured and forced to be part of the Suicide Squad again. Also, because it's 2018, 2018, the idea of forcing a woman to do something isn't really a positive look on your film. So you want, even if she's a criminal, you know, and especially Harley Quinn, who's so beloved by the comic book community and fans. So, and especially Margot Robbie's interpretation by some of the film fans is beloved as well. So to me, that is more the idea that I get your point, but I don't think it's going to harm her in any way to have her be back for Suicide Squad 2. And I think it's between Mark Ellis and Perry about the burpees. I'll be honest with you. I couldn't do more than five before I'm dead.
Really?
Not at this stage of my physical career. Yeah. Maybe 2 years ago.
I got to think of my burpee breakdown, but that'll take me a minute. With Harley Quinn, I agree. I don't think the fact that she got captured multiple times takes away from her menacing quality. I actually think being locked away almost enhances it, too, especially when you consider the scenes that we got of her being locked away.
Oh, yeah.
That just shows how unhinged and crazy she really can get. Mm-hmm. So if anything, I think that kind of makes her even kind of zanier and scarier to me. But what I think would possibly keep her out of Suicide Squad 2 is Birds of Prey.
Sure.
Especially because all of this talk about James Gunn's version of Suicide Squad 2 basically having an entirely new take. Mm-hmm. I think if he does that, he's going to want to wipe the slate completely clean. And I don't think that necessarily would even mean close the door on Margot Robbie's Harley Quinn to, let's say, James Gunn gets to make another Suicide Squad movie. I don't think it would stop her from coming in at that point. But with her focus so heavily on Birds of Prey and establishing that team, if these two movies come out in close proximity to one another, I don't think she's going to be in both.
Yeah, I think that's right, because you've got all these other films she's going to be a part of. There's only so much time Margot Robbie has in her life to do these films. She's also working on so many other films and producing so many other films. So this is a woman who wants to become, in essence, a mogul in this town, or at least a very powerful production company with all the work that she does. She's very smart, and she's grabbed this town by the horns and taking care of business for herself. So for her to do multiple Harley Quinn movies, I would be very surprised. She might do a cameo, maybe a couple of scenes like Ben Affleck did as Batman in the first Suicide Squad, that would make sense. But her being a full-time member on three or four separate films would be way too much.
I don't even see her doing any kind of cameo type thing, especially when you consider the path that Margot Robbie is taking her career, and where she's not just appearing in things.
Yeah.
She's taking control of the projects that she's part of. And I just get this feeling that if she doesn't have something to say when it comes to a big production that's taking up a good deal of time, she might not do it, whether it's from an acting perspective or a producerial perspective. Yeah. It just seems like she's really pushing to have like a certain amount of meatiness to everything that she does.
Yeah,
but more importantly, the burpee question.
Yes.
So I can do, whenever we do Tabata, I'm four burpees for every 20-second set. But if we're talking about 5 minutes of burpees, I think I have to probably say something like 10 burpees a minute. So 50 burpees?
I wish I could do 50
that. Seems like a bit much, because now I'm already like feeling my arms burn out by the fifth minute, even though I'm not doing burpees right now.
Well, it's the little ones like you that can do burpees well. It's the bigger dudes who have trouble doing burpees, or the bigger people, because it's more time stretching out, more time jumping up and doing the thing, and then down, and then it just makes more time. I was always frustrated in CrossFit watching the little people burpee like it's no big deal. It drove me insane.
This sounds like one big excuse.
Well, I could always out deadlift them, that's for sure.
That's true. All right. Question number four.
Okay. This one comes from Instagram. It's from at KGibbsF1. Hey, Collider folks, with the success of Venom hinting that the Sony Marvel Universe might have mileage, is it possible that Sony might recast Spider-Man to bring the character into its universe, while allowing Tom Holland to continue to portray the role in the MCU? Would two separate Spider-Men with two different actors in two separate universes be too confusing for casual moviegoers?
To that specific question, yes. I think it would be messy and confusing, but this would never, ever in a million years happen. It's one or the other. I would love to bet that within whatever contract that the two companies have signed together, it's this is Spider-Man and this can only be the Spider-Man, with the exception of an animated Spider-Man.
Right.
I think Sony Animation definitely left the door open to continue the Spider-Verse series, but when it came to a live action Spider-Man, it's basically Tom Holland until it isn't Tom Holland anymore.
Right. Well, that's a great point you bring up, and that's what I was looking at here, the idea of the end of the... I think they're going to see how Into the Spider-Verse goes. I don't always, Perry's more right. Perry's more often right than I am, but every once in a while we disagree on certain things, and I imagine I'm going to be wrong, but I have a feeling about this, and that is that I do think it's possible actually have Miles Morales as a Spider-Man in the Venom universe and have Tom Holland as a Spider-Man in the MCU universe, and then eventually down the road bring them together as we're going to see this this December in Into the Spider-Verse, where you have them crossing dimensions. Anything is possible. Nowhere in the Venom Spider-Man does it say it's happening in our current dimension. It is what it is. It's set in its own timeline outside of Tom Holland's Spider-Man for now. So I don't know how they're going to go down the road, but I think it's certainly possible, and I'm sure Tom Holland wouldn't mind being like, you know what, I'll just be Spider-Man over here in the MCU, and I don't need to swing into Sony's Venom universe or whatever they're creating there, and you know, Miles Morales can take care of it, because they kind of messed with the mythology already in Homecoming and added Miles Morales' best friend to Tom Holland's Peter Parker, so that's certainly possible.
I'm going to take a baby step in your direction, because I think the Miles Morales point is a valid point, except for the fact that I guess because of Into the Spider-Verse, I don't know if they're necessarily going to do that live action all of a sudden, because then within Sony, you would have a little bit of confusion. But I wouldn't be surprised if they brought a character like Miles into that, you know, whatever Venom just started, whatever we're calling that. But then I keep thinking about just the name Spider-Man.
Yeah.
Like, no matter who, what character is under the mask, I just keep seeing, like, the little TM next to Spider-Man. It's like one Spider-Man, you know? And if Marvel Studios was smart about this business move, they would make sure to have that character on lock in fear of... It's like, We know that Miles Morales is different from Peter Parker, but when you consider the amount of moviegoers that go to see an MCU movie and basically skyrocket it to billion dollar movies, I don't think that as many of them know that Miles Morales is different from Peter Parker. They're just going to hear Spider-Man. And that is cause for confusion to me.
Well, I hear your point, and certainly it's, as I said, you're more often right than I am about these things.
You never know.
But you never know.
Don't give me credit in this situation, because I'm telling you, when it comes to the, like, who could have predicted Venom was, well, actually, some people, I should give credit, some people really believed in the brand, so good on you if you did, but really, Venom blew away so many expectations, you really never know.
Yeah, and the idea there with Venom is, that's a new character in essence. People had seen it in Spider-Man, three or something like, Topher Grace playing Eddie. So they knew to a degree, but to this level, it lets you know that people are becoming more aware of these characters, and you don't necessarily have to spoon feed them and worry about spoon feeding them. You can throw a character like Miles Morales. The fact that they threw in Donald Glover, who is Miles Morales' uncle in the comics, the character he played in Spider-Man Homecoming is his uncle in the comics, that lets you know that there's a possibility Donald Glover could switch over, go into the Venom universe and have Miles Morales be a part of it. That's how you kind of work your way through it. But Perry makes a great point. You kind of want to own the Spider-Man character if you're going to use the Spider-Man character, because it brings so much attention and so much brand recognition to your overall brand. So yeah, I hear you.
I'm so curious to see how this pans out, because it's just like, as we discuss this, my mind kind of spirals out of control with all different possibilities. Like, for a hot second there, I was even thinking, you know, Given the success of Venom, I imagine Sony has some confidence to the point that they'll never need to take characters from the MCU. They're going to want to build with the foundation that they themselves creatively have started. Yeah. But I don't know. Then when I really think about it, depending on what the deal was and when it expires, I mean, I guess it behooves them to take these characters that a studio like Marvel has already established. But
yeah.
I'm so curious. I just can't wait to see. I wish I could, like, peek into the future, like, 5 years. Not even 5 years. I want to see Sony's next movie in that cinematic universe, because I think at that point in time, depending on how that movie's received and how it does, that's when we're going to start to see not necessarily a definitive path forward for them in terms of Marvel properties, but a little bit of a firmer visual than what we have right now, because I think what we have right now is a total crapshoot for them.
Yeah, agreed.
All right, one more.
Yeah, our last question here. Is that you?
That is me. Sorry, it's a Twitter question. You can read it if you want.
No.
This one comes from Gregory Doff, who writes, "What is the furthest you have traveled to see a movie, be it a festival or a single screening? Or what is the most interesting locale you can recall seeing a movie in?"
All right, so here is the quick thing. I never flew to another country to see a movie. I saw a movie in other countries, I just never flew to it. So I immediately eliminated those for the first part of the question. So I will say this. In 2003, I was living with a couple of friends, my friend Michael and Ian, we were living together, and we saw online that they were having an early screening of 28 Days Later in San Diego. And this was 6 o'clock in the afternoon or 5:30, something like that. I had noticed it on the computer. I called the boys into the room. I was like, do you guys want to take a chance and drive all the way down to San Diego to see 28 Days? Because it's not showing in LA. We can see an early screening down in the gas lamp district. This was not Comic-Con. This was just a regular June or July. Yeah, I guess it was a June time in 2003. And so we just bought the tickets. Like, we're just like, screw it, let's do it. You know, let's go. And we jumped in the car and we drove to San Diego. We got there maybe 10 minutes before the film was going to start, grabbed our popcorn, jumped into the seats, and sat down and enjoyed 28 Days Later. And it was just a random thing. We were in the mood. We were younger than we were. And we're like, let's get in the car and go and try this thing. And we had a great time going down. It was a great road trip for 2.5. I mean, the drive back was a little wonky because it was late at night, but it was still a fun thing to do. Other than that, I once walked 38 blocks in London to see Blade 2. I would say that. And the last thing, where's the weirdest place I saw a movie? I would say Vienna. At the time, I went to Vienna for 10 days. I fell in love with a girl in the Shakespeare chat room, and we stayed together for 10 days there in Vienna.
Wait, what?
Yeah, we met. Back in the 90s, you could go into chat rooms and get to know people, and I met her in a Shakespeare chat room, and we're still friends now. We still communicate now. She lives in Vienna there. And so I went to see her in Vienna at her school, at her college. I was in college as well, 98. And I took 10 days, visited Vienna. And one of the things she took me to, because she knew I was huge into movies, we went to festivals while we were there. But we went to see The Big Lebowski in this, like, corner alley with like maybe 45, 50 fold out seats with a bar where you could buy beer. And I'd never been in a movie showing place where you can buy beer. And I sat there and had a couple of beers with her as we watched Lebowski screened on the side of a building. And that was one of the most interesting experiences back in 98 for me as a moviegoer to see a movie in. So that's
I don't even care about my answers anymore. I just want to ask you about this chat room relationship. Chat room, was that what it was?
Yeah, it was a chat room. You could go in there, like Excite and Yahoo had chat rooms. You could go in, log in.
I remember AOL chat rooms.
AOL chat rooms too, yeah, but I would find the specific ones that were about Shakespeare because I was into Shakespeare and acting at the time. And we would have this, we never saw a picture of each other. We communicated, we fell in love over writing and over and talking on the phone and over a chat. And we sent letters to each other for months. I flew to London to study in 98, and then there was a 10-day break, and I went back and forth about whether I was gonna fly to Vienna to see her, because we'd never seen each other, and all my friends were like, don't you do this. She could be, she could be a dude, you don't know. This was before catfishing, I think, was available or was a thing. And I flew to Vienna completely blind, like not knowing what she looked like or anything. And we had the greatest 10 days ever. And you know, it couldn't last because I was still trying to figure out if I wanted to be an actor or not, and I came back to the States. She wanted me to stay and leave school and stay in Vienna with her and pursue our relationship, but in the end I couldn't do that.
I wish I had made this question first so we could just talk about it for the rest of the episode. Because we have to wrap this up though. Really quickly, funny thing, you bring up Vienna. That's probably the furthest I've traveled, because I covered the Mission Impossible Rogue Nation premiere.
Nice.
And that's where they had that one. But traveling, you know, myself, I went to Iceland to see my short film version of Child Eater when it played at the Reykjavik International Film Festival, and I got to stay with the director and his family, and it was easily one of the best trips I've ever been on. We also saw a whole bunch of other movies at that festival, which were great. And then weirdest place that I saw a movie was very recently. It was when they took us to Mexico City for The Nun, and we watched The Nun in the ex-convent, and it was just perfect timing too, because the second that we got out of the car to walk up to the convent, I mean, torrential downpour, thunder, lightning, everything. The scene was just so perfect, and because so much of the imagery in the movie looked like the building that we were in, the whole screening almost had this feeling of where, like, they blended into each other. It's like the images on the scene on the screen blended into like the dome roof above us. And it just had a really, really interesting touch to it. I love that.
That's awesome.
All right. That's it. You know what time it is right now? It's time for me to sleep off this Zizel. That's what it is. Thank you guys for bearing with me. Roka, as always, thank you for
being here.
Don't forget to like and share this episode of Collider Mailbag, and we will see you tomorrow for another one of them.
Hey, everybody. Mark Ellis here. Thanks for watching this episode. You want to watch more? Then click up here. Or you can click right here for more great content from Collider. If you haven't subscribed to Collider Video, do so right now and share this vid with your friends. Thanks for watching.